As I was introduced, my topic is about nutrition, a big, big topic, that a word, a concept, an idea that we've all spoken about from time to time. But in reality, it seems to me that we haven't been able to find very much consensus about what that word really means. So I want to share with you some of the stuff that I've learned in the last 60 plus years with many students and colleagues and others on this question concerning what is nutrition? And what is the right kind of food to eat in order to get the best possible health? In any case, let me start out with a big idea. It's one that's sort of come to me over the years, but I think it's worth saying. Namely, nutrition, when done right, can create more health than all the pills and procedures combined. I know that's a big, startling idea, but I really mean that. If we do it right, if we eat the right food, we get away from drugs, we can be healthy. So there's a problem, basically, and this is the problem I want to address here. Nutrition is not taught in medical schools. There's not a medical school in the United States that properly teaches nutrition, hardly at all in many of them. Secondly, among the 130 or so medical specialties, which is a sort of the procedure by which physicians are reimbursed for services, of the 130 medical specialties that we now have, not one is called nutrition. So here's a problem. Here are the professionals who are supposed to be offering us their services in the area of healthcare are not being taught the one subject that is the most important in my view of all. And secondly, even if they didn't know something about it and they got some training, they're not really going to be able to get reimbursed for services. Therein lies some of the problem with the fact that some people, many people in this country, have difficulty understanding what this question is really all about. And of course, as I mentioned, the public is massively confused. That's one of the reasons. And it needs to be solved, because there's so much to offer, actually. It's very difficult to know, quite frankly, and I think you would agree with this, that one of the problems with this issue about confusion, it's very difficult to know for the average person to know whether or not a claim, radio, TV, and conversation, or whatever, it's very difficult to know how valid that claim may be. And I'm sure many of you know that claims are all over the map, quite in contrast with each other. So, as I look back over the years that I've been involved in this, I've sort of sorted out a couple of ideas that if we stick to these two ideas alone, we'll get to that sort of land that I'm talking about where so much health can be created. First off, eat whole foods. Whole foods. Not the individual nutrients and food fragments within them. And by that I mean I'm talking about, you know, nutrient supplements. We've done a lot of research on nutrient supplements. It's a huge industry, multi-billion dollars a year. 50% of the population uses nutrient supplements as a means to nutrition. I'm not talking about that. Nutrients taken out of food, out of the context, do not do exactly the same thing for the most part that they do with when they're in food. And secondly, there are fragments taken out of even plants, incidentally, and I'm referring to plants as a good form of nutrition. Even the stuff that's taken out of plants, like oil, sugar, if you will, maybe the right kind of food in a sense, but when we take it out and use it separately, we get a different response than what we do, generally speaking, than the whole food. Plants, this is another idea to keep in mind, plants provide all the protein we need. That's somewhere around 8 to 10% of total calories. That turns out, if you look at the literature more carefully, that's enough. We do not need to eat animal foods to get the animal protein. Plants have all the protein we need to have. So it's just those two ideas. Whole food, obviously meaning plants, because they don't need the animal protein, animal foods go along with it. That combination really works. Now, my career started, as I said, many, many years ago, and I happened to come across an idea when I was working with the Philippines, in the Philippines, helping to coordinate a national program in feeding malnourished children, where in fact our efforts were intended to actually make sure these children got enough protein, even good quality protein, animal protein, if you like. And I saw something that sort of didn't exactly agree with that. I won't get into all those details. But it led to this question. animal-based protein, which was my background, did not look to be as good as it was touted to be. So we organized the study. And so we started looking into this question, is protein as good as what we think it is, as I had thought it was? Here's one little display of some information among hundreds of things like this. Cancer, we all tend to agree, starts with a gene being mutated. Okay, it's happening more or less all the time in some of our cells. So it starts with a gene mutation, normal cell to a cancer cell. And so as a result of it starting with a gene, if we have cancer genes, we're going to get cancer, right? That leads to sort of some suggestions we should get analyzed for genetic background and this and that. But it's not, cancer is not, in my view, a genetic disease, even though that's the most highly touted maxim, if you will, of the cancer industry. Here's what happens. This is an experimental animal study that we used in much of my career early on. We start with a mutated gene, and we follow the progression of the early cancer over the first 12 weeks. If we fed lower levels of protein, 5%, remember I said that 10% is fine, it's good enough? So if we start with 5%, and we feed the animals who have the mutated gene, the 5% protein, we get no cancer. If we feed them, on the other hand, the higher levels of protein, 20%, we get lots of cancer. So here's a striking difference between 5 and 20%. But then we went to the next question. I wanted to know whether or not, what happened if we just switched the diet back and forth between 5% and 20%? So starting with 20%, okay, in the first 3 weeks, the cancers are growing. These are precancerous lesions, if you will. Switch it to 5%, it turns it off. 20%, we turned it back on again. 5%, we turned it off. That was striking. At that time, still is today for a lot of people. Because if we assume that cancer is all coming from genes, and if you have the genes, you're going to get cancer maybe. If you don't, you won't, if you will. In this particular case, what we were showing was nutrition was important. So it leads to this idea here. We may have cancer genes, all of us, whether we're born with them or whether they're created during our lifetime, they're sort of hanging around. They remain basically silent until they're nourished. So it puts the onus then on the question concerning nutrition being the cause of cancer, not genetics. You know, we think of nutrition in a very simplistic way. We tend to think of individual nutrients doing their individual things. We value foods according to how much nutrients have this, that, or something else. And so most of our thinking about nutrition is focused on individual nutrients. In reality, it turns out and this is just one thought, it turns out the amount of nutrients we consume, let's say in a spoonful, a cupful, whatever, we can know how much is there in theory, but that has little relationship to how much nutrient there may be at the functional site, wherever that may be in the body. So the amount we're consuming here has almost nothing to do, quantitatively speaking, with the amount that's operating in the functional site, which raises a question. There's a lot going on between here and there, and it's sort of an activity of biological activity is very, very complex. And then individual nutrients, when they're examined for their activities, generally we think of, and this is the way it tends to get taught, this nutrient causes this response, and here's the mechanism by which it works. That's the way we tend to think, and that's the way, you know, cause and effect relationships often happen. It turns out that in our hands, the protein turned on the cancer. I wanted to know what was the mechanism by which it worked, which enzyme, which transport mechanism, or what have you might be working. That's the basis for the entire drug industry in large measure. If we see something going wrong and we want to solve the problem, we want to know what the mechanism is. So maybe we can make a chemical to block it if we wish, or enhance it, whatever the case may be. It turned out in our hands, the protein caused cancer, but not by one mechanism. Every time we looked for a mechanism, in a sense, we found one. Got up to about 10 or so, and a couple of those mechanisms, not only was the protein turning on the process, it was actually attenuating or minimizing the effect of those processes that tend to protect us. So the high protein diet was actually sort of getting a whole bucket full of mechanisms working together as in like a symphony. to create the response. It was a very exciting idea. Again, it shows some degree of complexity, which I would suggest is really important in this consideration. And then this leads us to the idea that nutrients work best in whole foods, as I mentioned before. They work best in whole foods. You take them out, work with them individually, altogether different, oftentimes. Sometimes they work sort of the way you expect them to do, but it's not necessarily a lifestyle practice. So those three observations, they are pointed to a different philosophical concept regarding what nutrition is. It's not a function of individual nutrients and adding up these effects. It's all of them basically working together. When we consume the foods, animal-based foods, in order to get all that good protein we've heard so much about, what that tends to do is to displace the consumption of the foods that we otherwise should be consuming. So when we look at the totality of the food effect on various disease processes, it's not just one thing working, be it protein or anything else. It's a combination of that, the presence of those nutrients, as opposed to the lack of those things that are not there. Now we know, we've got good evidence for this, and not generally known. That kind of diet, we've heard from our grandmothers, eat your vegetables and so forth and so on, to prevent future disease. I'm not sure we paid a lot of attention to that, especially when we're young. We figure out we're going to get a solution to that problem when it comes. But in reality, now we know, and this is not yet published very well, namely, the kind of diet that actually prevents future problems, when it's done right, actually can be used to treat existing problems. So now we have altogether new paradigm, if you will. Instead of relying on single chemicals, be they drugs or whatever else, to correct the problem, now we can simply look at this kind of food to start doing it. And it happens very quickly. Within 10 days, 2 weeks or so, you can see remarkable changes occur in our sort of biochemistries, if you will. Once we get to thinking about food as a means of treatment, we're in a different territory. It's something really meaningful in that case, because you can see the results so fast. And there's a lot of people now doing this as a result of some of the work we did and some of my colleagues. This is now being tried by people, and many of you here, I think, probably would agree to that. You switch, you got a problem, you can see the results very quickly without side effects. Why is nutrition not taken seriously by the medical profession? As I said before, it's not. It needs to be taken seriously. Medicine, or the practice of medicine, whether we're doing research or practicing, is what I call reductionist. We're looking at one thing at a time. We're looking at just this disease, not some other disease, just this disease. We're looking at usually just one antidote, this drug or that nutrient, if you will. And also, at the same time, we're thinking about one mechanism at a time. And so medicine is a reductionist process. That's what our system is. It's highly reductionist. And we now know we have a lot of problems with that approach. Things are not working like they should. There's a lot of evidence to show that. It's also very, very expensive. And if we're going to rely on that highly technical sort of philosophy to keep us well, we need third-party care, namely the doctors or others. In contrast, nutrition, when everything is working together, as in a symphony, as I suggested, it turns out working basically comprehensively. It's not working one mechanism. All of these seem to be changed the same way in the same direction to create the same response. That's a very exciting concept. That in turn leads us to just wonder at what kind of foods we eat to get that effect. And that's first person health care. All of a sudden now the locus of control becomes back to us. All we need to do, just do it. And then that way we can actually eliminate a substantial proportion of pharmaceuticals for our treatment or other pills and procedures. And finally, I want to ask the question, why is nutrition not taken seriously by the nutrition science community? You probably thought that they are taking it seriously. I'm not sure they are. I've been in that community for, as I say, a very, very long time. We have problems. And the sense is that the problems are largely related to too much corporate interference and control. Whether it's coming in the form of money that may be supplying the funding, which sort of tethers us to that idea, or whether it's coming from our participation with corporate sectors on the outside. Not that we shouldn't do it. We need to do that. We need to have this relationship. That's not the issue. But the corporate influence is such now that we keep falling back on pills and procedures looking at things very specifically. And we're losing track. We're not getting the essence of what we can learn from nutrition. So this happens also at the level of policy. I spent about 20 years in national policy development, where we're attempting to translate the latest science into something we can tell the public. And once again, it's a very complex process. But the center of that interaction is, again, falling back on looking at things in a very, very fine way. And so in the whole process, whether practice medicine, in policy development, or doing research, which we did a lot of that, just focus on one thing at a time, we're losing track of what really matters. And so we're doing that, I would suggest, to use a tough word, our system is corrupted. It's seriously corrupted from top to bottom. And we're all part of it. We're all part of it. And what we really need to do is to do it right and make people well. Because the cost to the society at large is huge. Cost of health care being the highest per capita of any country in the world. Let's redesign nutrition. I call it nutrition renaissance. I'm almost in a position of throwing away what we have done in the past, gather this new idea, and then using it to actually help to explain, basically, cancer. Because I would argue that we are in a position now to take the evidence we now have and just go forward and do that. Thank you very much.